the Expedition 34 crew members take their turn on board after 12 straight years of crewed operations on the International Space Station. And they're excited to get to work focused on advancing the station's long-term goals.
This space station really represents, to me, the very first big cooperative effort between the most affluent nations on this planet coming together to do something all toward one goal.
And that is to do science that can't be done on the surface of the Earth. That is the core purpose of the space station. And so our job, as the people on board, is to make sure that that science gets done.
The idea is to see how the space factor affects not only the different experiments and different materials, but to see how it affects us, real living humans, how it affects our bodies.
A long-term existence under the conditions of zero-G leaves its trace even on a healthy person, such as a cosmonaut.
The zero gravity reduces our muscle tone, our muscles atrophy, including our heart and the cardiovascular system atrophies, the bones atrophy, decrease in bone mineral density.
It's as if you spent months or years, even decades on Earth, happening in just a few months in orbit. And using changes in exercise and changes in diet, we have basically found a way to beat that type of aging, beat that type of osteoporosis.
So all of this accelerated aging process and the means by which we figure out exactly what's going on, even in the cellular level, how to fix it, exercise, diet, medications, other things. All of those things stand to benefit us on the Earth.
And why do we do this? We do this to gain a lot of experience, to prepare for subsequent flights, more long-duration flights to other planets.
And the research on the people is only part of the plan. For instance, there are also investigations in technology development, because things in space work differently than they do on Earth.
You're lucky in your car because your fuel is always on the bottom of the tank. We're not that lucky in space. We have to design a tank so that that fuel is always ready by the pump there to be pulled down the line and sent to the engine or to whatever kind of device it's going to drive.
The potential from the station is great, starting with the visual observations of the Earth, various natural disasters and phenomena, and as well as the events in space.
There are different experiments with growing biocrystals, because here on Earth it is impossible to grow perfect crystal, because it is not the right correct shape as it should have been. There are very different experiments. Well, the main idea, of course, is to use all the potential of zero gravity of space and also the various factors of space flight to test various materials and products, maybe test some medicines.
The human crew members are test subjects for some experiments and lab assistants for others, and spend the rest of their time making sure the station operates safely and efficiently. That can mean routine maintenance inside the station. That can mean spacewalks to do repairs outside the station, though none are currently planned for this increment. And that can mean supporting the missions of a small fleet of uncrewed cargo ships that keep the station and its crews supplied. Visits are targeted within the Expedition 34 and 35 timeframe by the Russian Progress Vehicle, Europe's Automated Transfer Vehicle, and two American commercial ships, Space Exploration Technologies Corporation's Dragon and the Cygnus from Orbital Sciences Corporation, the second participant in the Commercial Orbital Transportation Services program. Expedition 34 wraps up when Ford, Novitskiy, and Tarelkin come home in March, leaving Hadfield to assume command of the station for Expedition 35 and become the first Canadian astronaut ever to command any space vehicle. He sees this as the next logical step in Canada's history of space exploration, from the Alouette 1 satellite launched 50 years ago, to the first Canadian astronauts on space shuttle and space station crews, to pioneering space robotics that built the International Space Station.
It's a big deal for me, but also it's a big deal for my country, for my space agency, and for where I'm from. And so I'm happy that people are interested in it, but I'm fundamentally happy that this is a continuation of all of those capabilities, and it continues to open opportunities for the Canadians that follow after me.
Hadfield's crew expands in late March when a Soyuz spacecraft delivers former station commander Pavel Vinogradov, first-time flyer Alexander Mazurkin, and space shuttle veteran astronaut Chris Cassidy, making his second trip to the International Space Station. They'll join the growing line of space travelers from around the world who have served on board the International Space Station to get Earthmen and women prepared to leave their little corner of the solar system in the years to come.
We're building on a lot of accomplishments and successes of astronauts that have gone up there before us, and they've been able to build efficiencies and get more science done. We want to do that, and if we can, do it even better.